in unity. We are joined the kingdom of God. It's not coming to science in the church. Nor will they say, no, here it is, or there. For the kingdom of God is within. 26 years living. I know a few places. I see the rule. If everything I see seems so complete to be independent of my perception of it, it is really within. When they say, all that you become, though it appears to come, it is within. In your own imagination, for if this world of mortality is not yet, is that is the human imagination the only thing fast enough to contain the essence of space? And is the human imagination part of the presence we call God? But I need to call God with human imagination. I do not start to close the gap between God. That we all think the moment of God. I just can't forget this thing. If God truly is my imagination, and all things are possible to him, I should be able to test him. If you're called upon to test him, to test yourself and see, do you not realize that Jesus Christ is in thee? Unless, of course, you fail to make the test. But how to make the test? How should I go about making the test? Well, first of all, I'm going to ask of you what I ask of everyone that I address. Paul says in his letter to the Galatians, let him who is taught share all good things with him who teaches. So Paul was not asking for any earthly goods that the people had to have. He was asking them to share with him the results of their experiments. That he in turn could take their stories and tell it to others to encourage their faith. So I'm going to ask you to test it. And then share with me the results of your testing. Not only that, your dream. Your visions. I would like to hear them. For that's how God reveals himself to himself in man. We are told if there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and I will speak with him in a dream. Now, this is what a friend of mine did here recently. This man, I must tell you, is a very successful, I would say, businessman. He's a writer. But he's always busy writing for pictures, writing for TV, and his income is enormous. He never misses a meeting in LA. And here recently, he sent me this letter. He said, you've asked me to share with you any experience of mine, such as a vision, a dream, all my practical down-to-earth experiences in the application of this principle. For here is a dream. He said, first of all, I must preface the dream. And then he asked me in his letter if I was familiar with Berkeley Square, where the central character tries to convince the girl that he can move from one century to another, say the 20th century to the 18th century. And then he likens it to someone on a river, and his destination is around the bay. His present is where he is on the boat. His future is around the bay. But someone elevated above the earth, having a view of both sides of the river, will see the man's future and his present as present. where that man is going, and where he is, will be present to the one elevated. Where is it my being began in this manner? I was the observer from above. I looked down and I saw infinite possibilities of man. You couldn't conceive of a plot, whether it be a plot of a tragedy or some glorious plot, some horrible thing or some marvelous thing, but every conceivable plot that man could ever conceive, everyone was present. Worked out in the most minute detail. And strangely enough, they were all contained in a prone man. Here is a form of a prone man. So we said, don't ask me how infinite states of consciousness, infinite possibilities, could be limited by the form of a man. But there it was. I'm only telling you what I experienced. When I contemplated this, it was the deadest thing I had ever seen. And yet I shouldn't use the word dead, because something that is dead suggests it must have lived. There's a previous life to it. It is now dead. So it's simply an inanimate thing. I looked at it, and then I began to wink on Sunset Boulevard, opposite Ralph's supermarket. People were on the sidewalks, there were cars on the street, but everything was frozen. But everything was frozen. Three-dimensional, but frozen. And I knew that I alone could analyze. And I knew that I myself was frozen. I looked at myself, I'm just like the others, all frozen. And I knew only as I became alive would they become alive. And so I took a step. And I seemed to pass through an invisible curtain. At that very moment of taking the step, everyone became alive and began to move, the sound, the noise, the action, everything. And I knew that it was something I was trying to remember. What is it I am trying to remember? I kept on walking. I must have gone a block. It seemed like a normal walk, the kind of walk I take every day. And everything is alive and independent of me. And then I remembered. As I remembered, I turned around and looked. And changed the focus of my attention. And place it back above. And everything once more became frozen and lifeless. From this exalted state, I remembered I didn't talk to them. And for some strange reason, I wanted to speak with people. And at that moment, I found myself in the living room where a party was in progress. But they were frozen. And as I entered, I was frozen. And I wondered, am I the host? Am I the guest? They all seemed to know me, and I don't know one of them. And for a moment I panicked. For I knew the party had come to an end, and I didn't know where to go. So I remembered. I completely forgot. 1 second before, as I became involved in the party. Then I'm trying to remember something. I remembered the Sunset Boulevard experience. Remembering that, and how I escaped from it, I walked over to a seat, a chair. I sat down and closed my eyes. And then I changed the focus of my attention. The one small place is not here, it's the party, but above. I opened my eyes, and they're all frozen. Everyone is frozen. And then I felt myself once more above. At this exalted state, I looked way down, and here is myself on a bed. And I had what I considered a wonderful idea. Now I know I can change, move myself from its present state into the not desirable state that I would like to experience. And then I realized how impossible that would be. From this level, I can't change any state. These states are permanent. I would have to go down and identify myself with that being. And from that level, once more, play the game. And so, at that moment, I began to awake. I'm on my bed. And I have no knowledge of the dream. To me, it's 6:30 in the morning, and I can't conceive that I'm in a dream. I went to my library and started the negative recording of your last lecture. And something you said triggered the dream. And it all came back in detail as I just told you. Then I said, did I dream it last night? Or did I dream it long, long, long ago? I don't know. But, however, it thrilled me, and so I thought I'd share it with you. Then at the very end, to make it a light matter, he said, I went to my doctor, and he said, in fact, congratulated me on my rapid physical recovery. And he asked me if I'd done something, and if so, tell him all about it. So I said, I did it all in my imagination. I imagine I was in your office, and you were saying to me exactly what you said. And then I began to explain to him how imagination works, that imagination creates reality. He said to me in an elderly philosophical manner, you know, my wife thinks things like that. Wasn't very flattering. But he said, this is a strange experience. We're out driving recently on Sunday afternoon, and the radio was turned in to a ball game. And this man is coming to bat, and I dislike him. And I say to my wife, he's showing me the big league. He can't hit, he can't catch, and he can't run. What right is he playing in the big league? And she said to me, you shouldn't think things like that. You should think nice things about him and see him doing wonderful things. He said, all right, I will. I'll see him hit a home run. He steps to the plate, and the first ball bit. He bounced it into the bleachers. And then said he to his wife, I'll never do that again. It's too fast. But I must tell you, the lecture that triggered the memory of the dream. For here we all are seated in this room, and we think we are here and completely this. And what his dream signifies, we will not take to heart. And yet you are the animating power of the universe. The whole vast world is moving around you because you're identified with the present state. Well, the thing he began to record is this. I found myself in dream, but not knowing that it was a dream. I found myself on a crowded subway train in New York City. I was talking to my friend David, but the train was literally crowded to the gutters. I heard the voice of the conductor say, please, do not press against the doors, they may spring. But the people couldn't help it. But in spite of the crowd, I could see them individually, distinctly. And the ladies were more beautiful than each other. I mean, they're all beautiful and beautifully guarded. And I turned to my friend David. I said, David, how can I believe, how can you believe, that all that we behold, though it appears without, it is within, in our imagination. And this whole vast world is simply a shadow? How could these lovely ladies be in me? And the train. And the train was as long as the station allowed. When he agreed, he couldn't possibly, on this level, accept it. Then the train stopped and we got off. Walked up the stairs to the plaza. Then you say to me, you're going by the post office, aren't you? I said, yes. He said, do me a favor and post these letters for me. I took the letters and said, are they properly stamped and addressed? And I casually come, because I was curious who he's writing, just to see that they were properly stamped. I waved goodbye to him and turned in the direction of the post office, and he went the opposite direction. And I found myself waiting. Will they nominate me? So what conclusion can I reach? Objectivity and subjectivity are fully determined for the individual by the level on which his consciousness is focused. On reflection, it's subjective. When I was actually having the experience, it wasn't subjective. It was objective. Only when I woke and reflected upon the experience did I refer to it as a subjective experience. This is now objective. An hour from now, if you think of this room and the meeting, to you will be a subjective experience, a memory image. So I say, everything is truly within. Now you can test it. You take a dream, a daydream, or something you want for yourself, or something you want for another. And you represent to yourself a scene which, if true, implies the fulfillment of that dream. You might do this, that, and the other. And so you construct a scene. Any kind of a scene implies the fulfillment of your desire. And then to the degree that you are self-persuaded of the reality of that imaginal act, it will become fact in your world. I could tell you unnumbered stories to support that claim. It's not theory of me anymore. This is fact, based upon experience. So when we are told in the book of Luke, the kingdom of God is within you, you can take it literally. These garments that you and I wear are parts of the eternal structure of the universe. You are wearing the garment as an act to wear the costume. You are not the garment you wear. You are doing this for a purpose, a heavenly purpose, but you are not these garments. You are that being that my friend discovered who sees it from above. And to see this universe from above is so completely unlike what it appears to be seen from this angle. It's not this way at all. But you come down into this world of death for a purpose. Now, Blake made this observation, and he claims he did not write it from his conscious reasoning mind, that the words were dictated by the spirit of love. Well, God is love. Therefore, if the spirit of love dictated the words of Jerusalem, then it's God dictated. And in this he said, those in great eternity who contemplate on love, or rather contemplate on death, say this. What seems to be is, to those to whom it seems to be, even of torments, despair, and eternal death. But divine mercy steps beyond and redeems man in the body of Jesus. But that's something that man can grasp, understand. But I tell you, it is true. To stand in the presence of the risen Christ and commune with him face to face and voice to voice, then you have love, his infinite love, embrace you. And as he embraces you, you fuse with him without loss of identity, no change in your identity. And yet you are one with the body of Christ. And then he sends you. And he can't say you love himself because you're one with him. There's no divorce, no separation in that moment of. So when he makes the statement, divine mercy steps beyond and redeems man in the body of Christ. So in my last little pamphlet, I made this statement, and I made it with brilliance. That you and I are resurrected one by one to unite into a single man who is God. So here is a reflection he saw in his dream. A man, crown, containing infinity, and the deadest thing he ever seen. God places a limitation, and then takes upon himself that limitation, and reaches in this act the very limit of contraction, that he may then expand beyond what he was. He takes upon himself the limit of opacity, and then begins to expand, and there's no limit to translucence, to transparency. This is the world called the world of death. But while we are in it, and we ourselves are animating it, we can get any state we desire. There are infinite number of states. You can be in a poor state, or a wealthy state. You're not better off as far as the height goes, because one is poor and one is wealthy. Not from a spiritual point of view. But while you're in the world of season, why not be comfortable? Why not take a state that cushions and comforts? And so you can take a state of affluence if you know what it would be like, who you have to. Assume that you are, and see the world as you would see it were it true. And then, accept it. Believe in the reality of that unseen imaginal act. And if you do, it will come to pass. Because the whole vast world really is within you. I don't care what others will tell you, it's all within you. And everyone moving in your world moves because of you. William James made the statement that the greatest revolution in his time was the discovery that man, by changing the inner attitudes of his mind, could change the other aspects of his life. Now, James belongs to our generation, this century. He's gone from the world, but he was the great educator of the 20th century. And he said the greatest revolution in his time was this discovery. Well, the great book of books, the Bible, makes that statement. Not as James made it, but how would you interpret this? Whatever you desire, believe that you have received it, and you will. Isn't that the one condition imposed upon me or you is to persuade self that we have it? How can I persuade myself when at the moment reason denies it and my senses deny it? But James said he could change the inner attitudes of his mind. Can anyone stop you from changing your attitude towards the speaker? You may like him or dislike him. And if your dislike of him causes him to act, to confirm your dislike, and you like the dislike, well, then keep it up. If you don't like that reaction, you could change your attitude towards him, and he automatically and unknowingly would act in the way that you would like. And you can make it with any person in this world. So if I am that free, that I don't have to get your permission to hold an opinion on it, but I can hold it regardless of it. And if I hold it and persuade myself of the reality of that opinion on it, and you conform to it, am I not free? I am free to entertain any thought, and if I am, and it produces results, well then I'm a free person, even in the world of Caesar. So here, I do hope that I have persuaded you that the whole vast world, though you seem so small, insignificant to yourself, that the whole vast universe is really with you. And so you can take it this day and test it. You're invited to test it. And when you get the results, share it with me. Tell me about it. Write me a letter. And explain what you did and how it worked. And if you're blessed this night with a vision, I would love to hear it. For God makes himself known to man in vision. And he speaks to the man through a dream. Don't try to interpret the dream. Tell me just what happened. I pray did not attempt to interpret it. He told me exactly what happened when my lecture that he was about to record triggered the memory of the dream. But all through his experiences, what lesson he was learning was this. I forgot. I must remember. If everyone could now persuade himself you're trying to remember something, you lost the memory of it when you came this low in the scale. But you're trying to remember. What he was trying to remember was that exalted position where he saw the whole thing as dead. When he came down into the body of death and completely forgot who he really was. But people are shocked when you tell them that they are Christ. All ends run through the origins. If my origin is God, my end must be God. As the poet said, you see beyond the fields, the sesame was sesame, the corn was corn, the silence and the darkness knew, and so the man stayed born. If I believe what scientists tell me, that my origin is a worm, my end is a worm. If I believe in the Bible, and my origin is God, my end is God. And I don't accuse that anymore. I know that from experience. I don't have to speculate about the risen Christ. I don't have to speculate about God's new love. I stood in the presence of God. And he's infinite love. I'm not bending my head when I say God is man. As Blake said, thou art a man. God is no more. Thy own humanity learned to adore. God appears, and God is light to those poor souls who dwell in night, but does a human form display to those who dwell in realms of day. So here, you are wearing the form of God. You are God. He gave you his name. But the name that he reveals to the whole past world, if you take it, is all I am. So that's my name forever. And be known, I'll be known by it throughout all generations. But we don't stop there. We say, I am John, a poor John, an unknown John, an unwanted John. And these are the limitations and the restrictions we put upon the name of God. But if I remember the name, I would know about the name. I'm only put upon it that which is noble, that which is free. And if I did it, I would walk in that light. So, do me a favor and try it. Try it. I promise you from my own experience that you will get the results. You won't have to hound anyone in this world, but no one. Here's a simple little story. 2 weeks ago, just before I closed, I was about to close, and my wife said to me, you know, here's a little unfinished business. A friend of ours owes you some money. You've never asked him for it. You've never written. You've never mentioned it to anyone, but he owes you the money. You're closing up for the entire summer. You'll not be here until late fall. I don't think it's fair to him, fair to you, fair to me, that he continues indefinitely without ever mentioning the fact that he owes you the money. I said, all right, you want the money? He said, yes. I said, all right, I will do it my own way. I will not ask him for it. I will not write him for it. I will not phone him for it. But I will do it in my own way of imagination. So I imagined, first of all, he had the money. You can't get it from someone who has the money. So I first of all assumed he had it. And I went beyond that. You can have money and be unwilling to pay debt, you know. You may have millions. And oh, the grocery store. I still won't pay. So I first of all saw him with money, lots of money. And then I saw him willing and eager to pay me. And then I received from him whatever he owed me. This I did on Wednesday. On Friday, the phone rang about 4:30. It was my friend. He hadn't called me in over a year. He's on your busy flight. I said, yes, I'm actually tonight. He said, that's right, it's Friday night. Well, my wife and I will come to the meeting tonight. It's perfectly all right. So he came to the meeting. After the meeting, he said, you ride home with me. And Bill, who's my wife, she'll go home with the one who brought you. And my wife will go with you, with her. So we went on to the parking lot, and he always drove an old jalopy. Something falling apart. But I saw nothing like that in the lot. And he took me over to always this wonderful Chrysler, the New York model, with everything in it that money could buy. But he drove me home. A new car was under 1,000 miles. Not a word was said on the way home about money. Not a word was said at home. The one who drove my wife and his wife home left about 11:15. And then 5 minutes later, she opened her purse and said, that was long, long overdue. But I think you'll find it in order. And handed me a check for $1,200. I never asked for it. Never once in the 5 years he owed it did I ever breathe it. And he gave me, she gave me $1,200. This is how it works. If you believe in the reality of your own wonderful imaginal acts, it came out of the moment. And now he has money. Things roll in for him. He's completely out of debt and free of that feeling of owing friends money over so many, many years. So, try it, and then share with me the results of your experiment. And now, I think I'm going to ask my friends, the ushers, if that's the one you. Did you hear the question? Should we take every dream seriously, or only a few? And how will we distinguish the difference between a significant dream and just an ordinary dream? Well, first of all, every dream is a communication from God. Every dream has meaning. But we are past masters at misinterpreting the dream. Quite often we need the help of someone who understands the universal language of symbolism. And there is the universal language of symbolism. But if, for instance, I have a dream concerning a pancake, it doesn't mean I'm going to have roast pork for dinner. A pig is a universal symbol of the Redeemer of the universe. And the Redeemer and the Creator are one. So, follow the reasoning behind the pig. What was it in the story of the pig? I had that dream. Here was this little pig, an enormous interior, where they were displaying flowers and plants, all kinds of vegetation. And just at closing time, I noticed there was a little pig, a little rabbit. And so seeing no one around, I picked him up and placed him on something as tall as this. And then I took some flowers, I took some green leaves, and made a bed for him. And I also knew that it may not be the best food for him, but he could survive on flowers and leaves until someone opened the place the next day. And then, as happens in dreams, they just appreciate it. And now I'm on the inside of an enormous supermarket. I'm looking down, here's the pig. And the pig is a tall, thin, rangy fellow, quite thin. but I come in as a proclaiming God. And then I look at him, I knew he was the same Vic. And I say to my daughter, Vicky, I said, Vicky, give me some crackers for the pig. And she said, I haven't any money, Dad. I said, all this belongs to us. Ask no favors, don't take the two crackers. Meanwhile, I started needing something to feed him. And my brother picked the cream pie and he said, what are you doing? I'm getting some food for my pig. And then he added some very thick looking bread. Keeping her hands. I thanked him, I started to complete this kneading. And then my daughter went over to a huge pyramid of crackers. And she pulled one from the base, which unbalanced the entire picture, and they all fell. As they fell, it revealed a little candle, about 4 inches tall. And the candle was lit. And I said to her, that's my candle. Then the words from scripture came into my mind. The words of Job and the words of Proverbs. The spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. And when his candle shines upon my forehead, by its light I walk through darkness. So I say to Vicky, do not put the crackers back. That's lit now. It must never be hid again. Never be put under a bay, under a bushel, under anything. Now that that light is lit, you must remain lit. And then I walk. Fire is the universal symbol of the Redeemer. When I come to the magic creates reality, I'm told it. It isn't a day in my life, I don't have opportunities to exercise it. The thinness of the pig revealed to me I have not been as faithful to the feeding of Christ as I should have been. He symbolized Christ. And I knew how to feed him by exercising my imagination lovingly on behalf of others. When I saw the opportunity to help and didn't exercise my imagination lovingly on behalf of the other who needed help, I didn't feed him. I am feeding Christ every time I exercise my imagination and give it a finger. So that's the interpretation of that thing. If I didn't know the language of symbolism, I would wonder what am I doing for a pig? And the whole thing would seem so stupid. Yet that was communicating to me my lack of exercising what I knew. Now everyone knows the magic creates reality, so you can't judge them. But if you know it, and you don't exercise it, you are not feeding Christ. Any other questions? Wrath. Water and wine, you find it all through the Bible. The wrath will be the most literal translation of the scripture. The most literal. Water is when you see the psychological meaning behind the story. So, upon that literal story, you bring forth water. You're told in the book of Genesis, he came into the field, and the well was covered with a rock, a stone. He rolled away the stone, and watered the sheep, and then he rolled it back again. So every man comes to the rock, which is the Bible, the rock of God. He sees, if he knows how to read, he can read it. But he has to turn it into water. So he turns stone into water, getting the psychological meaning of the story. His use of that stone, psychologically, converts water into wine. So we are told in Timothy's letter, Paul tells Timothy, drink no more water. Use a little wine for your stomach's sake. And your many infirmities. In other words, don't completely absorb the psychological meaning all day long and never apply it. Take a little wine now. Now, if you take that literally, you may go get plastic. But he doesn't mean it that way. He means take what you know the truth and use it. The use of it turns the water into wine. I tell you both. Thank you. I don't hear you correctly. It's, shall we say, of a child. Of your child's the grace of all significance. The child is something created. Christ is always symbolized as a child. Always a child. Christ is the creative power and the wisdom of God. And that power is always personified as a child. Always. In the 8th chapter of Proverbs. And when he created the world, before he wrote down anything, I stood beside him as a little child. And I was daily his delight. For I am his creative power, his wisdom. He who finds me finds life. He who misses me injures himself. He who hates me loves death. And so you find with a child. The day will come, you will all bring forth the Christ child. Everyone will give birth to Christ. And bring forth that power of God, wrapped in swaddling clothes in the form of a little babe. Self-explanatory. You would have been worried about something, and you hear a voice before me asking you, what are you worrying about? And telling you not to worry, and reveals itself in two glorious eyes, and you are concerned? No. Look upon that as the most wonderful symbol of help. But there has been lots of dreams now. And yet, so that anyone stays in it. In the course of the day, you and I change state after state after state, number of states in the course of the day. But we do have one to which we return constantly. That's where we live. That state, that emotion to which we most often return, constitutes the true self, the true state. That's the one that's always catching up. If I don't like the fruit that it bears, I should do something about planting a new kind of a state or tree. But the individual planting, for instance, like the money I got from my friend, I did it eventually. He gave it to me on Friday. In the interval, I didn't do it again. Never thought of it again. My wife asked me to do it for this unfinished business, so I did it. Well, now the Bible teaches that the vision has its own appointed hour. It ripens, it will flower. If it be long, then wait. For it is sure, and it will not be late. Not be late for itself. No two impregnations have the same interval of time between conception and birth. A child, if it be human, takes 9 months. A horse takes 12. A kitten takes three weeks. And so, seeds have their different intervals of time. That's true also of concepts. Man can conceive himself to be this, that, or the other. And then that interval between the conception and its birth is determined by the nature of the conception. Any other questions? All this goes to the end. The end is where we begin. What would it be like were it true? That's the end, isn't it? I have no concern with the means. I go to the end, and the end determines the means. If I have ways and means, you know not of. My ways are past my end. So all we are concerned with here is the end. Going to the end remains. remaining vague for one moment to get the reaction to the script that he knows would come with success. But then something happened.